Are the Canadian taxpayers ever going to get their money back on this deal? Is there a possibility that we're throwing good money after bad?
Well, I think those are two separate questions. In terms of what we're putting into this deal, we're putting some money into debt. A lot of that we believe will come back. We will get paid eventually. Money we're putting into equity will be worth what we can sell it for on the market. We're certainly not assuming by any means that we'll get that money back. But the question is it good money after bad? We would not do it if we thought it was good money after bad. Ourselves and the Obama administration have made the stakeholders here, management, the unions, the bondholders, the financial institutions, take some pretty deep cuts to ensure that these are viable companies. You remember in March, we even refused to accept their initial restructuring plan. So we have made them make the very difficult decisions we think are necessary to make these smaller but viable companies in the long term.
But we put hundreds of millions of dollars in here in the past. How did the companies fail?
Well, I'm not an expert on the automobile industry, and I don't intend to be running an automobile company. The truth is, I think that the companies made a series of very bad decisions over a very long period of time, and ultimately didn't supply the customer what the customer wanted at a reasonable price to make the company profitable. But obviously, there's been big restructurings here of the various lines. Product lines. There's a rationalization of dealerships. There's a great reduction in labor costs and benefits. These things are all—they're very difficult for those involved. We should not minimize how much this will affect some ordinary working families who have taken these reductions. But they are necessary to make the companies viable.
The number of jobs that are going to be saved—4,400 hourly jobs—comes at quite a price per worker. Perhaps $2 million or something along those lines, perhaps less if we talk about the number of jobs that are saved in the parts, suppliers, industries. Is that still a good deal?
The number is much higher. I've seen that number bandied about. But when you look at GM and Chrysler together, we're not just talking about the number of people who work for those companies. Those jobs are responsible directly for at least five parts jobs for every one job in the assembly line. You've also got then the effect of dealerships. If you lost those jobs, the collateral damage you would have in the other automakers and other parts suppliers because the industry is integrated, not to mention the effects it would have on the general economy in places like Oshawa, St. Catharines, Ingersoll, you name it. Fact of the matter is, Ken, and it's very difficult for me as a conservative to come to terms with this, but the fact is this, the reality is this. Either we put this money in to save all of those jobs, to make sure we have a viable company in the long term, or the entire thing moves to the United States and will not come back. You have to remember here, this is not a normal corporate restructuring. The Bush administration, followed by the Obama administration, decided that they would politically restructure these companies, these large companies. And if we do not participate in that, those companies will simply be restructured out of Canada. That would have an immense shock to our economy and probably significant long-term consequences. So this is the better, by far, of the two options. But neither of these are pleasant options for the taxpayers.
But that's the position we find ourselves in now.
Yeah.
If we go back 4 years when Standard & Poor's first said that GM's debt was junk bond status, one could argue that this could have been foreseen and that perhaps we should have started developing a comprehensive automotive industry strategy for our country. I mean, is it possible that out of this will come a new strategy? If you'll pardon me, it seems right now as if we're just patching holes in the dike, as opposed to looking forward where we might have had an opportunity to develop a new Canadian car, maybe something that's socially, environmentally, economically viable.
Well, both the governments of Canada and the government of Ontario are putting funds into those kinds of programs. That said, I think the truth is that these companies, General Motors we're talking about today, have been badly run for a long period of time. And the truth of the matter is, I don't think any responsible Canadian government would have jumped in and said, without the United States doing anything, that we would restructure these companies and make them viable. It wouldn't have been possible, it wouldn't have been reasonable. On the other hand, once the Americans did it, I think the truth is we had no choice but to participate if we wanted to maintain our share of these very large companies in Canada. So I think ultimately, you know, how an auto company is run is going to have to be the responsibility of the auto company. Unfortunately, for the taxpayers of our country, as I said in press conference earlier today, the taxpayers of Canada, the taxpayers of Ontario are not responsible for the mismanagement of these companies. But unfortunately, the consequences of that mismanagement are our responsibility, or at least fall on us. The consequences would fall very badly on us, and this is a better option than simply letting them be moved out of the country.
Is there another option? The fact that General Motors over the last decade has lost 40,000 jobs, that Toyota and Honda have created 50,000 jobs, that maybe you take that same money and build 7-8 new plants with a different automotive company and let General Motors go. I mean, are we sending the wrong message? Are we funding the guys who cut jobs and leaving the guys who were creating jobs?
Well, let's remember that there have been changes in the industry. Obviously, the so-called Detroit 3 have shrunk, and frankly, with these packages, will shrink further. General Motors will be a 40% smaller company. Other companies like Toyota have been growing. But let's remember that all the other companies, the Toyotas, the Hondas, actually support what we're doing here. Because the truth is, they're all fed by an integrated supply chain, and if we had the failure, in the case of General Motors, of the single biggest player in the supply chain, it would have immediate impacts on all of the auto companies, including the ones that traditionally have been growing. So as I say, it's an interesting option. One, I will be frank that, at one point we discussed, what about letting this go and putting the money elsewhere? But the truth is, the shock to the system would be enormous. And as much as we've had to take some difficult decisions, we do come out of it with a viable company. If you simply threw all that money into a new venture, then I think you're taking even greater risk.
Rolling the dice even more. Is this the end of it? Is this the last investment?
I believe so. I we would not be putting this money in unless we thought the new companies, the smaller companies, will be viable in the long haul. There is no way, even with the American government participating, I was very clear, we will not put money into these unless the companies that come out at the other end are going to be viable. Management, the unions, the bondholders, these guys have looked into the abyss and have made now the very difficult decisions they've needed to make in terms of their costs to have a competitive company. And, in our case, we could afford it. I can tell you one of the reasons I'm sure it won't happen again is when I look at the deficit situation in the United States, there's no way they're going to be able to afford something like this ever again. So I think we've got it right this time. But obviously, a lot of it, in the free marketplace, a lot of it ultimately depends on the ability of management to read consumer moods and to respond appropriately. But they've been given a pretty severe wake-up call here.
The new CEO, Fritz Henriksen, have you met him yet?
I have not met him, but I know that various ministers of our government have been in touch with him.
And you have confidence that this company is now going to survive?
We would not be putting money in unless what was there is viable. They've now brought their cost structure down to industry averages. They've done the difficult rationalizations they're going to have to do. Let's not forget, when we keep talking about how much taxpayers' money we're putting in here, the unions have put their own money in. They've taken it out of their labor costs. The management have had to take big haircuts. Bondholders have, quite frankly, lost virtually everything they held. So others have also had to make the difficult financial decisions to make these viable.
Prime Minister Stephen Harper, thank you.
Thanks for having me, Ken.
How does it go without gas and air? How does it go without sparks and explosions? How does it go without gears or transmissions? How does it go, you will ask yourself. And then you will ask, how did we go so long without it? The electric car. It isn't coming. It's here.